Our third lecturer will be Dr. Olech, who is currently the division chief of rheumatology in the Department of Internal Medicine at the University of Madison School of Medicine. She will present us on genetics for rheumatology. She is an adjunct faculty here at Dillon. We're very glad that she'll talk to us about this.
Thank you. I want to make sure that Michael includes that my association with Niven, because I'm very proud of it, probably even more proud than my association with Allison. So thank you for inviting me to give a talk here today, and especially since I decided to talk about my favorite disease, rheumatoid arthritis, as you can't talk about genetics of rheumatology. And also, rheumatoid arthritis is the most common rheumatic diseases that we see in the clinic. The prevalence of rheumatoid arthritis is approximately 1%, I guess similar to schizophrenia, which makes over 1.3 million people in the United States. Women are affected about 2 to 3 times more often than men. And RA usually occurs in the middle-aged population, but really any it can start at any age, including young adults or elderly as well. So both the environmental factors as well as genetic factors play a role in risk for rheumatoid arthritis. Studies have shown that smoking was associated with the risk of developing RA. And in terms of the heritable factors, we have a study with the monozygotic twins showing about 15% concordance, as well as there is increased familial clustering. So the major genetic contribution comes from the HLA locus, and the first HLA association with rheumatoid arthritis was already reported 40 years ago in 1976. So HLA DRB1 is encoded by the major histocompatibility complex, and it's been shown to be associated not only with the risk of RA development, but also the severity of the disease. So what has been found is that alleles share a similar amino acid sequence at the position 70 to 74 in the peptide binding groove of the HLA-DRB1 molecule, and that led to the shared epitope hypothesis. So according to this hypothesis, these peptides allow presentation of these arthritogenic peptides to the T cells. And however, these peptides have never been found. In about 1990s, a new test has been discovered called anti-citrullinated peptide antibody, or ECPA, or anti-CCP, which we actually use in the clinic for the diagnosis of patients with rheumatoid arthritis. It's present in about 60 to 70% of RA patients. We also use that test for prediction of more severe disease. So what the studies have shown is that shared epitope alleles mainly predispose to ECPA-positive RA. However, risk factors for ECPA-negative RA has also been found, which is HLA-DRB1-03. So now, since we found this association with HLA-DRB1 about 40 years ago, obviously with the new advances in genetics, we found many more genetic risks, loci predisposing to the development of rheumatoid arthritis. So this is one of the studies, probably the largest and the most recent. It's an analysis that includes, it combines about 100,000 individuals of European and Asian ancestry. And it looked at the risk factors about 10 million SNPs. So you see here on this graph susceptibility loci that rank by effect size. with the y-axis being odds ratio. It's probably too small for you to see, but basically what it shows is that HLA DRB1 still remained the most the strongest related to the development of rheumatoid arthritis, with the odds ratio being 2.3. And then the second one is PTPN22, with the odds ratio being 1.3. All the other ones are, the association is modest. So overall from this study, we know that HLA explains the majority of genetic risk, about 13%, with 5% of genetic risk being explained by additional 100 loci discovered today. So we do have quite a few studies already with some input on the genetics in rheumatoid arthritis. However, we don't really use any of this in the clinic, including the old one, the shared epitope. We don't really need to use any genetic test to diagnose patients with advanced rheumatoid arthritis. Their diagnosis is relatively easy. Patients have classic symptoms, especially when they present already with full-blown disease. However, it would be great to be able to use these data in order to find these patients early, before they developed the disease, or at least at the beginning they started having the joint symptoms. And why? Because we have quite a few studies now showing that if we treat RA patients early and aggressively, the patients do better, mainly because we're preventing their disease progression and joint destruction and disability. But also the studies are showing that they actually have, those patients that are treated early, they have better prognosis and better chance for remission, including drug-free remission. And I think this should be the future of rheumatology and rheumatoid arthritis, to try to find these people that have risk for rheumatoid arthritis and perhaps treat them early and prevent them from developing full-blown disease. And this is probably one of the most unmet needs in rheumatoid arthritis, because we do have a lot of medications now approved for RA. You can see them here. Those include the old traditional disease-modifying anti-rheumatic drugs and the biologic drugs, which the first one, Enbrel and Remicade, were approved in 1999. And since then, like mushrooms after the rain, all these new drugs have started coming out, including the most recent one, Small Molecule. So we have all these great drugs for rheumatoid arthritis, but this is what's happening in our clinic. And this is just an example of a typical patient that I see every day, as well as other colleagues, rheumatologists. So this patient's name is Carolyn. She's a 53-year-old woman. She has severe seropositive anti-CCP or ACPA-positive rheumatoid arthritis, and she was diagnosed about 8 years ago. This is her treatment history. She tried methotrexate, leflunomide. She tried sulfasalazine, hydroxychloroquine, biologics, different biologics. And look what happens is she either had a side effect or she had insufficient response. Finally, 8 years later, we found a drug that worked for her, and she is actually doing right now well. Wouldn't it be nice to know 8 years ago that this patient is going to do well on this drug? I think that would be a game changer for many of the patients. It would save cost of medicine as well. Unfortunately, we don't have any markers that would predict response to treatment or predict the toxicity to the drugs. There has been a lot of interest in this area, and we have a lot of studies now published. Listed here are all the most important pharmacogenomic studies in RA patients who are treated with either traditional disease-modifying agents or biologics, anti-TNF agents mainly. Unfortunately, the data are very conflicting. And why? There are some possible reasons for these inconsistent results. So first, because RA is really not homogeneous. It is heterogenic disease despite that all patients have joint pain, but patients are different, and we see that multiple phenotypes can result from the same genotype or vice versa. Another possible reason is RA is a complex disease with probably multiple genes involved, and we know that the data that I presented earlier. And those genes are involved in different response and efficacy and toxicity to drugs. And lastly, it's not that easy with rheumatoid arthritis as with cancers, because usually in oncology the tissue is available for analysis, versus it is difficult to obtain synovial tissue in rheumatoid arthritis patients. So we usually base our studies on the blood sample, which may not reflect the actual pathogenesis of RA. But there are some good studies, especially lately. This is a study that was just published in 2014. It's a systematic review and meta-analysis that identified genetic variant associations with methotrexate efficacy and toxicity. Methotrexate is number one drug we use in RA. Every single patient that's being diagnosed with RA usually is being started with that drug. So it is a very important data for us. This meta-analysis included 87 studies, and it showed that RFC1, which is the reduced folate carrier 1 gene, ADG, was associated with methotrexate efficacy only, not the toxicity. But it's still a valuable data. The odds ratio was 1.42. Another good study, now based on genome-wide association study, which included 2,700 of RA patients from 13 different cohorts treated with one of the three most commonly used anti-TNF-alpha inhibitors, found that this SNP, I'm going to read the number, at the 1Q23 locus was associated with change in disease activity score in patients who were treated with etanercept, so one of the biologics. Unfortunately, not the others. It is already a good data to know. I wish I was able to know that to start treating when I start planning treating patients with etanercept. This study, unfortunately, was only done in RA patients of European ancestry. And this shows the association with all patients, etanercept, infliximab, and avalimumab. And another good and important study was just published last year in JAMA. It was a registry study. It had Norfolk Arthritis Register that included a lot of patients with also radiographs, and it looked into the association of HLA-DRB1 haplotypes not only with rituximab, with the rheumatoid arthritis severity, but also mortality and treatment response to different drugs. And interestingly, it found that Valine, at position 11 of the HLA-DRB1, showed the strongest association with radiological damage, joint destruction, with the odds ratio of 1.75. It also showed the association with higher all-cause mortality with the hazard ratio 1.16. And it also was associated with better response to anti-TNF-alpha inhibitors. The odds ratio was 1:1.4. So not the greatest, but still, I think, valuable data that possibly we could use in the clinic. So just to summarize this short talk, despite all these, first we do have quite a few advances. In addition to old HLA-DRB1 genetic factor, we now have over 100 RA-associated variants that have been confirmed through the genome-wide association studies. However, despite all these advances, the genetic testing, unfortunately, has not been incorporated in management of patients with rheumatoid arthritis. So, as I mentioned, the personalized medicine is the most unmet need in rheumatoid arthritis right now for mainly early diagnosis, also prognosis, but also predicting response to treatment. So I'm, again, very proud of being affiliated with NIPIN and hope to possibly address some of these unmet needs in the future. And also, I'm very anxious to get my whole genome scanned to look for my risk factors for RA, as my mother, who you see on this picture, has severe rheumatoid arthritis. Thank you.